Jai Ho, Om Guruve Namah. Before I begin, I would like to invite Sadhika Pragba Ji to bless us with Mangala Charan.
Namo Arhantanam, Namo Siddhanam, Namo Ayariyanam. Namo Vajrayanam, Namo Loye Savasahunam. Arhant Vitrak Paramatma, Nirgrant Sadgurudev, Agam Vani Ko Bhav Bandhan, Bodhi Pradata, पूज्य गुरुवर्या वैभव श्री जी महाराज के चरणों में वंदन नमन। सृष्टि से प्रतिपल मिल रहे सहयोग के लिए आभार। उपस्थित सभी भव्यात्माओं की भव्यता को प्रणाम। विराट टॉक्स के एपिसोड 3 में आप सभी का स्वागत और बधाई। विराट युद्ध चरम मंगल को उनके इस जोशीले एफर्ट्स के लिए तन्वांगी कैरी ऑन।
थैंक यू सो मच फॉर ऑस्पिशियस स्टार्ट। अ वार्म वेलकम टू एवरीवन ऑन विराट टॉक्स एपिसोड 3 डे 2। टुडे वी आर
Tanvangi, we are unable to hear. Can you please start again? We can't hear you.
Jai Ho, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yesterday, we heard Mr. Gautam Ji Jain. Honestly, I'm not into business. I don't understand ABC or business. But when I heard him, it was a great experience and I was mesmerized and I was excited for today. So before we begin, I would like to tell you a little about Virat Youth Charam Mangal. Virat Youth Charam Mangal is a group of youngsters from all over India connected with one aim in their mind, to share the blessings that we have received from Virat Guruji and Pujya Guruvarya Vaibhav Sriji Maharasa. And Virat Talks is a platform created by us where we invite dignitaries to share their life story, which will inspire the youth to come. Now, when I heard about Mr. Devinder Ji, I got the word entrepreneur and I Googled it. And Google said, entrepreneur is a person. What the life without a little. I'm sorry, can you hear me?
Yeah, carry on.
So today we have Mr. Devendra Ji Surana, who was voted as the Entrepreneur of the Year 2019. Thank you for joining with us, sir. Before we begin, I have a set of guidelines I want to tell you. First, keep your audios and videos off until asked by the host themselves, because it will create a distraction for the speaker. And second, if you have any questions, you can post them in the Zoom chat box or the YouTube comment box, or you can post your messages in the WhatsApp group that you are added. Now, to introduce our today's personality, I would like to invite Lakshita Jain from Jalore.
Audible?
Yeah.
Jai Ho, first of all, I would like to thank Marasa for giving me this golden opportunity. And I am super excited to introduce the Entrepreneur of the Year 2019, Mr. Devendra Surana. He is a graduate in Mechanical Engineer and holds a postgraduate diploma in Management from IIM Bangalore and chosen as the brain of the batch. Mr. Surana is a Managing Director of Bhagyanagar India Limited and Director of Surana Solar Limited and Surana Telecom and Power Limited, which are listed companies under the Surana Group. he has been in the field of non-ferrous telecom industry for more than 3 decades and in the field of renewable energy industry for more than 2 decades. He is the past president of Federation of Andhra Pradesh Chambers of Commerce and Industry, that is FAPCI, and past chairman for Telangana State Council Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, that is FICCI. He is also a founder president of Young Entrepreneur Organization of Hyderabad Chapter and past president of Rotary Club of Hyderabad Deccan. He is also a member of governing body of University College of Engineering and Osmania University. He has been guest speaker at many management and educational institutes. Recently, Hyderabad Management Association has awarded Devendra Surana as an Entrepreneur of the Year 2019. He has been extensively traveled all over the world for promoting business activities and even attended various business fairs and exhibitions. He is also running Gulabchand Surana Charitable Hospital from past 30 years. It reflects that besides having great leadership qualities, he is having a great heart too. Thank you so much, sir, for setting such a great milestone in the field of industrial world, and we wish that this webinar inspired us to achieve that great heights. Without taking more time, I would like to invite Mr. Surana to share his journey with us. Thanks.
Thank you, Lakshita.
Lakshita, for introducing Devendraji to us. And now I would like to invite Mr. Devendraji Surana to share his exciting journey with us. Over to you, sir.
Jai ho, Marasa ko naman. You mentioned about my grandfather, Gulabchand Surana Charitable Trust. So I want to start this talk by the one mantra which he gave me at a very early age. He had a single mantra, which was, Subuddhi dijo, bubuddhi bisar jaijo. Let noble thoughts come to me from all directions and let me have absolutely no negative thought. So I try to put my life in this thought process. Today, while I will talk a little bit of my journey and the businesses which I have done over the years, but I thought it was more relevant for all the participants to share what are my views, the trends which I have seen over the years, and what I think is very important or interesting to understand going forward. So the first trend which I see in the world is Durga, Lakshmi, and Saraswati. These three words, the Hindu goddesses, have great significance in today's world. And if we are able to understand the significance of how things are changing in the world, we can do it in just three words. The world before World War II was the world of Durga. The person who had might had right. Jiski bhans, uski, jiski lathi, uski bhans. Whoever controlled gunpowder or military power ruled the world. And this was the European era. I think that is one thing which we have to understand, that when it was the period of Durga, everything related to who had physical power. Even if you look at a marriage alliances, we used to look at a person who was a hatta katta jawan or a well-built woman before we went into a marriage alliances. Everything was about might is right. Then there was a transition period and Durga gave way to Lakshmi. Lakshmi was the period from World War II probably up till today. And whoever had the economic right ruled the world without any obstruction. All politics also became about economics. And this was an era of America. America, with its MNCs, with its great marketing power, ruled the world. And anybody who had money could buy both physical power as well as everything else in the world. Literally, it was jiski dumdi uski chamdi. That was the sort of a world which we lived in And to be frank, most of the people of our community, I would call them Lakshmi Putra. Today, we all have good position in society because of the Lakshmi which we all possess and the way we are able to utilize Lakshmi. This was a period when everything depended on Lakshmi. Even when you wanted to look at a marriage alliances, it was all about a well-settled, person with a lot of money who will not have problems of money. We used to look at people who had money enough for 7 generations. We all know that is never enough. Money is never enough. And now we are in the transitionary era. I don't have to say much because you would have all guessed that now we are moving into an era of Saraswati. Saraswati doesn't mean bookish knowledge. It means creativity. It means innovation. It means a lot more than just bookish knowledge, because in the world of Google, information is not knowledge. Information is not enough. We need to do much more than information to move on and conquer this world. Definitely, the world is moving on to Asia. I think it is moving on mostly to China. India still has a chance, but we have to do a lot more in the era of creativity and innovation if we want to reach there. And I think talks like this will help people foster creativity in the world. When I'm talking of Saraswati, I think it is a nice time to tell about my educational journey. I did my engineering in Usmania University, the university for which now I'm on the board of governors. I have been taken on the board after so many years, and it's always a pride to be on the governing body of your own alma mater. So it was one of the proud moments in my life. Then I went on to do my MBA in IIM Bangalore. And when I went to IIM Bangalore, I must share that I felt, you know, insecure, because I was going from a college in Hyderabad and all the people in this college are going to be from IITs and all over the country, the best brains in the world. But I've seen once I reached IIM and if you put your mind and heart to it, it was not difficult. End of 2 years, I was chosen as the brain of the batch in IIM Bangalore also. So this is one of the proud achievements which I've had over the years. When we talk about Saraswati, you know, there is something which in our Jain religion, it is not very given as much importance as it should be given. The ultimate aim of Jain religion is Keval Gyan. Keval Gyan literally means only knowledge. Knowledge and only knowledge. So while it is probably okay to do Kriya and Shraddha and Bhakti, it is knowledge and only knowledge which is going to lead us to the path of the God. And that is what the God himself has told us. So we should look at Gyan as a basic way to godliness. The second thing which I wanted to talk when I talk about Saraswati is Sikh. In our Marwadi culture, in our we have something known as Sikh. When anybody comes, we send them off by giving some money. This was not the way it was supposed to be. Earlier, when people used to go to some other place, they used to stay for quite a few number of days. It was never a fly-by-night visit. And when somebody went to another city, the host was supposed to teach him something which was to give him livelihood. So even today, you will see that our community will be very good in certain areas of business throughout the country. That is because we teach each other something of our own trade. And Sikh is supposed to be that. Again, it is knowledge to be imparted to any guest who comes home. It is not simply giving money, which became the easy option for people to get away from spending a lot of time in teaching, which is definitely much more difficult than giving some money. So I think this is something which we should understand and understand the true meaning of Sikh in our religion and try to share our learnings, our way of being, our way of trading, and of course doing business. So this is the first trend which I wanted to share. The second trend which I wanted to share is change. Speed of change is exponential. We've always been hearing that change is going to be constant and change is not going to stop so soon. Do we need to be afraid of change or do we need to be excited by change? Let me put in another fact. The change which we have seen in the last 50 years will be nothing compared to the change which we will see in the next 10 years. Now just imagine yourself doing business or doing anything at all or the way you were doing 50 years back. Will you be relevant today? Will I be relevant today? That is a question which we all need to ask ourselves. For most people of my age, this question will worry them, probably say that my business is no longer going to be viable. But since I'm talking on the youth channel, it should excite you. The opportunities available in the next 10 years are going to be more than the opportunities available in the last 50 years. And we all know how the world has changed in the last 50 years. If you just think of small things like, you know, your smart mobiles, which came just 10 years back, you can't imagine life without a smart mobile today. Probably all of you are watching me today on smart mobile, sitting in the in your homes without any commute. This reminds me of my mother. The first time she saw a gramophone in the 1940s, her brother got a gramophone to their village and there was a music coming out. And everybody went behind the gramophone to see where the person who's singing is hiding. You know, we have come from that period to this period in less than one generation. And the next 10 years, we are going to see so much change that unless we are going to be prepared for it, we'll fall on the wayside. And if we are prepared for it, the excitement is going to be so much that we just can't imagine the amount of opportunities which are there. Just to highlight this point, I would like to bring in a few data points. Tatas and Birlas took three generations to reach the pinnacle of glory. Dhirubhai Ambani did it in one generation. Narayan Murthy worked for half his life and in the balanced life, he reached the same pinnacle of glory. Bharti Mittal in Airtel did it in 10 years. Flipkart and Oyo and everybody else did it in 3 years. So this is the way speed things are changing so fast that anybody today sitting anything without any background can reach 3 years where Tatas and Birlas took three generations. So this is the level of opportunity which is available for all the youth in the country today. There is another thing which I want to highlight. Very few people will highlight this, but I think the genesis of all thought processes of business should depend on this. Not many people know that the population of the world in just 100 years back was just 1 billion people. Yes, 1 billion people became 7 billion in 100 years. We have gone sevenfold increase in population in just 100 years. And the earth has sustained sevenfold increase in people. Not only sevenfold increase in people, each person today is consuming 8 to 10 times what his forefathers used to consume 100 years back. If you just think of your grandfather living in a village, he used to hardly buy probably one pair of cloth in a year. Today we buy so much more, whether it is cloth or steel or plastics or what have you, we are consuming so much more. So in just 100 years, the earth has provided 56 times more materials for us to consume. This is something of great importance to people who do business because we need to understand that this trend has been the basis for everything, whether it is interest rate, whether it is inflation, whether it is all sorts of businesses, whether it is the continuous increase in land prices, because the population has gone up seven times in just 100 years. There is a shortage of land because that is the rate at which the sustainability is happening. But on the other side, while the demand has gone up, everything is becoming much more cheaper. If you just look at it, what your parents could not afford, we all can afford. Whether it is a car or a scooter or air conditioner. I remember the first air conditioner, the split AC which I bought in the 80s, used to cost me 40,000. Today, after 40 years, when the value of rupee has come down so much, it is still cheaper than that. Everything has become cheaper. Telecom has become from 16 rupees a minute to maybe less than 1.6 paise per minute. So everything has become cheaper. How is this possible? When demand has gone up, everything has still become cheaper. And this is where I think is the crux of business. We need to look at productivity gains. Today, business is all about productivity gains. How can you use creativity, innovation, digitization, communication, mechanization, automation, and all these things which help us increase our productivity and bring the cost down? This is the key to business in the future. If you can start something on this page, you will become one of those people on the previous pages, the Dhirubhai Ambani or the Flipkart or the Mittal. But even if you can't start something which is on this page, if you can follow all this technology, you will do very well in business. And if you do delay in following the technology, I'm afraid that things will become very difficult to keep up with. So this is something which I feel we should all look at in our businesses, in our day-to-day life, how we can increase technology to improve our productivity, because that is where we will all be in the future. When I'm talking about this, I would like to take a small break by saying about the businesses which I have seen. I have said that the speed of change is so fast. So what has happened in my business in the last 50 years? My parents, my business, I am a second generation entrepreneur. I stay with my father. He is my inspiration in life. And even today, whenever I want to think of anything, the first thing I think is, if I tell this to my father, what will he say? What will he ask? Because my father taught me one thing. He used to only ask me questions and the answers used to automatically come. So if I just imagine my father for some time, I will understand what is the question he will ask in this situation. And if I answer that question, I am through. So in the last 50 years, we have been through various businesses, whether it is ferrous industry, maybe about 15, 20 products. Then copper industry, we started as a commodity player. Today, we supply copper to every automobile on the Indian road, to every switchgear on the Indian road. Probably every device which is there, there is some part of my copper in that device. We were also into telecom, which we started. We had a factory in Goa. We closed it down. We had a couple of other factories in Hyderabad, which we have shut down today. And now we are in solar power and real estate. So one thing which we need to understand, that change is happening so fast that unless we change along with the times, we will not be present. So whenever the time comes, we have to move on. There is no point in thinking that things are no longer the way they were 20 years back. We are not able to make margins. The margins are shrinking. Yes, they will shrink more. Unless you have productivity gains, creativity and innovation, it will be very difficult in future to sustain business. Forget about growing it. And if you follow this simple mantras on this page, you will not only grow the business, but grow it multifold. Now, what is the trend which happens now? In the future, the population has stopped growing. The 7 billion population which the world is will stagnate at around 10 billion people. One very startling fact is the number of births in the world is already stagnant. Yes, the number of births in the world is already stagnant. For the last 20 years, the number of children born in India is 2.3 crore people. It has not changed. Since mid-90s, every year only 2.3 crore children are born in India. The population is growing only because of longevity. So what is going to happen is the population is going to stop growing, but the productivity gains, which I showed in the earlier page, will continue. When the population stops growing, and the productivity gains continue, what will happen? We will move to era of surplus. Everything in the world will be in surplus. Already we are seeing signs of that, whether it is in data, whether it is in computing. The Moore's law of computing says that the power of computing goes up inversely very, very fast. So the cost of computing comes down. But this is happening in every other field which we see, whether it is in the field of data, communications, what we are doing, video conferencing today, all this, or whether it is in the way of transportation, everything this is going to happen. When I say that we move to an era of surplus, our community especially has been successful in an era of shortage when we used to hoard material, we used to store material and we used to make money. We have to move on from that. Era of surplus means materials has less value. Those who have materials will not be the kings of the future, but those who know how to manage the surplus will be the kings of tomorrow. These are a few people who have taken advantage of the era of surplus. Uber, Airbnb. Uber doesn't have any taxis, but it takes advantage of the surplus cars on the road. Airbnb doesn't have any hotels, but it takes advantage of the surplus rooms available throughout the world. YouTube does not create any content, and my talk today will be on YouTube, and probably they will make money out of that because, and they have not done anything. And all these people will take advantage of era of surplus. So we need to move into an era of surplus mindset and see how we can do business when everything will be in surplus rather than in shortage. So when I talk about an era of surplus, a lot of people confront me and say, how can you say there is an era of surplus? There is a shortage of water. There is a shortage of energy. There is a shortage of everything which we can think of. And as the population is growing, we will have more and more shortages. These are doomsday talkers whom I don't believe, because the mind, the human mind has so much more potential to create productivity that all the problems will be of past. I will tell you two stories which are very interesting. One story is of a conference in Paris. One of the biggest conference in Paris happened in the year 1895. That was the biggest problem in the world. And do you know actually what was the conference all about? It was about horseshit. I'm not joking, this was about horseshit, because there were so many tangas throughout the world that every city was full of horseshit and they didn't know what to do. So there was a huge conference to have that. Can you believe that somebody could have such a big problem? There is another story which I want to share. This is of a Thai king who went to meet Napoleon Bonaparte. When the Thai king went to meet Napoleon Bonaparte, he took with him an entourage of people. There were thousands of people who went from Thailand to France, and each of them was given a huge welcome with a fantastic banquet. And when such a big royal banquet was there, everybody was served according to his status in society. So some people were served in gold, some were served in silver, some were served in earthenware, some were served in aluminum, and some were served in brass. Do you know in which vessel the Thai king was served? The Thai king was served in an aluminum vessel. You will all wonder, why should the king be served in something which is so cheap? Because aluminum had just been invented there. They had been able to take out aluminum from the alumina which is available on Earth. We all know that a huge portion of the Earth is full of aluminum, but we just didn't know how to take the aluminum out of the mud. And that's the reason aluminum was more expensive than gold at that point of time. Today we can laugh. So before I get to this, I just want to say the two things which we think are of shortage today is water and power. I am in solar business, solar power. My brother looks after that business. And if you have, anybody has watched the solar power business, we used to sell power at 15 rupees per unit. And today we are selling power at 2.8 rupees a unit. That is the rate at which the power prices have fallen in less than 10 years. And solar power is going to power the earth. We talk about power shortage in the world. Just so that we all understand the amount of power the sun releases onto the earth, not throughout the world, not throughout the universe, just onto the earth. In just half a day, it is enough to power the entire world for the whole year. What power comes onto the earth in half a day is enough to power the entire world for the whole year. And that, I think, is the crux of the matter. We just don't know how to harness the power. Once we know how to harness the power, it will become that much more easy for us to get power everywhere. The other thing which we all talk about shortages is water. Do you know how much water we consume in a year? We consume 0.3% of the water available in the world every year. Just 0.3%. The problem is we do not know how to transfer the money, transfer the water to the place and in the form which it is required for being used in the world. So if we are able to get free power or very low cost power, it will become very easy to transfer power, water from any place to any place. The case in point is in Telangana, there is a huge water lifting program of Godavari. So the government of Telangana has started a program where water will be lifted all the way from the bottom of the river to hilltops. And this is now becoming viable because the cost of power is becoming cheaper and cheaper. And this will happen throughout the country, throughout the world. And power shortage will be a thing of the future, past. So this is my business mantra. To be successful in business, you know, when I did my MBA in IIM Bangalore, my professor gave me the business mantra. The purpose of a business is to satisfy the customer. Then when we passed out of IIM Bangalore, the gurus of those days started saying that the purpose of business is not just to satisfy the customers, but to make them, give them much more than what they were expecting. Now, my business mantra is, if you want to be successful in life, you need to make your customer lazy. If you can make your customer lazy, you will have your customer for life. If you make him work to come to you or to do business for you, you're going to lose that customer. Believe me, I use this principle every day in my business. So if I have to make a decision of any business, I put it against this test. If I change this formula of doing business, will the customer have to work a little more or a little less? If the customer has to work a little more, it won't work. I have to make sure that the customer works a little less. So I supply to the auto industry. My customer never tells me the schedule. He never tells me what material he wants. He never tells me how much material he wants. I have to be into his system to understand what he wants, when he wants, and where he wants. If I can deliver that without his telling me anything or raising a purchase order, I will be in business. If I start telling him your purchase order didn't come and I did not supply, next day he will have another supplier. So that is the way business is changing today. You need to make your customer lazy. You need to ensure that he doesn't have to do any work for coming to you for business. So if you look at all the successful businesses today, they make their customer lazy. Google, just type something and it'll give you everything. You look at, when I first did my project report, I had to spend 3 months to find all the data, go to about 6 libraries before I could do anything. The same thing I can do today sitting on my computer in half an hour, because the whole world's information is there available with us. That is what all these people are doing. They're making you lazy. They're giving you available things on your laptop, in your lap, literally, so that you can do your business much better. And it's not just on the digital part. If you look at luggage, people who are of older generation will remember Earlier, luggage used to be such that two people needed to lift it. Today, you don't see any of those luggage. Everything is like a trolley. Even a child can take a 26-inch suitcase and walk through the airport. So it is making the customer lazy is going to be the key of business in future. And if we can all follow this thing and make our customer lazy, we will be successful. So these are another two concepts which I would like to share. One is a black swan, especially today in the days of COVID era, when everything is changing. This is known as a black swan event. A black swan event is an event which is never foreseen. Until the first black swan was seen, everybody expected the swans to be white. And when the first black swan appeared, people said, yes, swans can be black. But until they saw the first one, they never thought it was possible. A black swan event is an event which can change the entire world, which can change the entire world without any thought or without any thought of what will happen to the world. And we are going to see more and more black swan events, things which will change, which we never thought possible, and the whole world will totally revolve 180 degrees. We need to be prepared for that. And to be prepared for a black swan event, you need to be anti-fragile. I will take a couple of minutes to explain the concept of anti-fragile. What is anti-fragile? Fragile is something which breaks. So if you take a glass and you drop it, if it is made out of glass like this, what will happen to the glass? It will break. So it is fragile. So what is anti-fragile? If you take a steel glass and if you drop it, it will not break. It will remain as it is. But it is still not anti-fragile. It is just solid. Anti-fragile is something when you hit it, when you break it, it will come back up bigger and better. So can you think of anything which will come back bigger and better when you hit it and hit it hard? This is a concept which is very important for being being successful, but also surviving in the future. So if I tell you what is antifragile, if you look at the human body, we are all antifragile. If you look at your muscles, if you don't exercise them, if you don't hit them on a regular basis, what will happen to your muscles? They will atrophy and go waste. Only when you keep exercising and hitting your muscles again and again, they become stronger. The same thing happens with your brain. Only when you tax your brain will become better. If you do not use your brain will become dead. So everything in life is anti-fragile. But somehow, we as people don't understand this concept of anti-fragile very well. What do we do in our houses? We protect our kids. We don't allow them to cross the road. We don't allow them to be exposed to strangers. We don't allow them to do work. Do you think you're strengthening your kids by doing that? Absolutely not. You need to ensure that they are more exposed to life. Only then they will become anti-fragile. And the things, like I said, a black swan event is going to hit them not once, not twice, but at least 10 times in their lifetime. We will see a lifetime black swan event maybe once, but our kids will see it 10 times. So unless they are prepared for the unknown, unless they are when they are fallen, they can come back at double strength. It is going to be very difficult in the future. And those who come back at a double strength will get glory like nobody else's dream. So we need to make our children anti-fragile. We need to make our society anti-fragile. We should not remain in dogma of the past, thinking of what happened earlier, and we should stay with the same thought process. Unless you renew the thought process continuously, we cannot remain as a society very successful. And believe me, It gives me great, immense joy and pride to be a Jain, because in the one generation in the Jains, I've seen so much change. I remember the days when, you know, when I first met my mother-in-law, she used to keep a ghungat. And if you see in just one generation, our girl childs today are more educated than all the men. In fact, even in the Zoom conference, both the people who talked before me were girls. Just 20 years back, it would have been impossible to imagine this type of a thing. So I am very happy that our people are becoming more anti-fragile. They are giving more thought to Saraswati as children and as society. We need to make our companies anti-fragile. How do you make your companies anti-fragile? Definitely not by increasing bureaucracy, which the PSUs do. What do the PSUs do? They have bureaucracy one level over another level, over another level. What has resulted because of that? They've all died. So you need to make your businesses agile and anti-fragile by ensuring that they can do more work continuously and react to a situation very much faster. So this is a very important concept which I thought has shaped my business thinking. Now, before I end, I wanted to end on a positive note. There are three opportunities which are there in India today. And I just want to spell out those three opportunities which are there. One, our base is very low. While we have talked that we are using a lot of money, a lot of materials compared to our grandfather and the forefathers, we are still using very, very low compared to the rest of the world. Our per capita income is today touching $2,000. I don't even want to compare with US, but even if you look at China today, they consume everything 8 to 10 times what India is consuming. So if you assume that India will reach where China is today in 20 years, we need a 10% growth. And that is going to be a huge opportunity for all of us. Second opportunity is demographics. I talked to you earlier about the population. Demographics is the number of young children in ratio to old children. For the first time, the working people in India has crossed 50%. So we can see today 50% of our people are working, and there are very few places in the world where this is happening. For the first time, when 50% of the people started working, that means the children and the old age is less than 50%. This happened for US in 1940. We know how US grew. This happened in Japan in 1970. We knew how Japan grew in those periods. This happened in Korea in 1980 and China in 1990. And we are today having this situation in India where 50% of the people are working in India. Even within India, I know today a lot of our viewers are from hinterland. So I wanted to take this opportunity of talking about this concept of Bimaru. I don't know if any of you have heard this. Bimaru stands for Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, and Uttar Pradesh. These are the states which are lagging behind in our country. But this is also because of demographics. Because the South India, this 50% happened in 2004, 2005. And the Bimaru states reached this position in 2015, 2018. So we are going to see an explosion of growth in these states in the next 10 years, the way we have seen in South and West in the earlier 10 years. So this is a very important part of the opportunity. The third part of opportunity is globalization and digitization. Extensive use of internet and digitization is ensuring that world is a flat place. Anything which can be done in US can be done today in a remote corner of Madhya Pradesh or Jalor or Jador, where a few of our people are today tuning in from. So anybody from anywhere can do anything. And if anybody can do anything from anywhere, why should there be a huge difference in the amount of money which they earn? So if somebody in the US is earning today 1 crore rupees, why should somebody in Rajasthan earn only 50,000 rupees? That is going to be the question. And the difference will narrow. These three things put together: low base, demographics, digitization, and globalization will reach will give us a situation, an opportunity in the world, which according to me, we are at a time and place in history, as well as geography, for an opportunity which comes not once in a year, not once in a decade, but once in a millennium. So in spite of all the problems which we are going to face because of COVID and because of China and because of so many other things, we are going to be in a very, very sweet spot in the next 10 to 15 years. And I personally feel that all of us, especially the youngsters, should take this opportunity with both hands and do it. Thank you very much. I was told to talk for 40 minutes. So I've completed in 40 minutes. If there are any Q&A, we can take that.
Thank you so much, sir. It was an enlightening session. You gave us a glimpse of the future. You took us through the past and told us about a lot about present. The point about, and you gave us a new concept of anti-fragile, and also you gave us a holistic view of business. Thank you so much, sir. I would like to welcome our yesterday's speaker, Mr. Gautam Jain.
Okay.
Thank you for joining us, sir. Now, I would like to pass on the mic to Aman Bhaiya for questions. Aman Talesra from Pali.
Jai Ho, sir. Sir, there are some questions for me. First question is that you founded that young entrepreneur organization. So, what quality you see in entrepreneurs? When you and their organization, when you hire them or when you select any startups?
So, YEO or Entrepreneurs Organization is an organization of entrepreneurs who have started their own businesses. But I think the question which you have asked is, what is it that makes an entrepreneur successful?
Yes. What quality you see?
I have a saying for that, you know, an entrepreneur has to have an impossible combination of two things in life. He has to be a poet and a banya. A poet to dream what could be done and a banya to take out the last paisa out of that situation. So these are the two combinations which is required for an entrepreneur to be successful. But if you ask me whether it is education or whether it is other things, I think it is passion. Passion and a relentless pursuit, continuous pursuit. Because an entrepreneur is never successful in the first attempt. He needs to continuously pursue his dream with relentless effort. Only then he can be successful.
Yes. So I got the answer actually. Banya and that combination is nice. Next question is from our viewers, from audience, from Deepak Kimte. Can you please screen on the Deepak Kimte screen, Parag?
And before we have Deepak Kimte ji asking his question, I would request Devendra ji to please, can you just put your screen off? Can you unshare? Yes. Thank you, sir.
Welcome, Gautam. Thank you first. Tuning in yesterday.
I was already on the screen long time, but okay. I didn't join. I was watching on YouTube actually.
Okay. Thank you. I enjoyed your talk yesterday. Thank you for joining today.
No, my pleasure. Yeah, I am enjoying your talk.
Yeah, Deepak's question.
Aman, you can ask his question. I suppose he has some internet issues. So you can ask his question.
Okay, I'll ask his question. Okay. So what are the qualities? Okay.
Hello.
Yeah, you can ask.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm there.
Yeah, can you ask?
Hello.
Yeah, Deepak.
Yeah, we can hear.
Yeah. Devendra ji, good evening. I have heard you and Narendraji Surana many times at many seminars and was inspired by your command on the subject. I have got few questions which are very relevant in the present scenario. As the words of this questions, the youth has lost the meaning and importance of these words. The three things which I wanted to ask, where you can enlighten us and the youth and share your experience with this important points. One is, what do you feel? What are the qualities a person should have or possess to be a good businessman? The second point is, what does ethical business means? And the third question is, what is the importance of commitment in a business?
Thanks, Deepak. I think business, like I mentioned earlier, passion, relentless passion towards your goal is the biggest requirement of business today. Without proper ethics and commitment, it is impossible to do any business in the world. Today, the value of word, especially I'm in the non-ferrous metals, the value of the word is much higher than anything else, whichever is there in, for any all of us. So I think unless there is that commitment to ensure that you honor your word and keep up the commitment, there is no point in doing business. Yeah, next question.
Okay. So we have got another question from audience, from Tarun Karnavat. I'll ask this question. One second. Yes, sir. Which are the new businesses you would like to recommend post-COVID, where we have new opportunities available?
See, a lot of things have changed because of COVID. COVID is definitely a watershed era as to the types of businesses which will happen. But having seen the trend, and I'm a passionate manufacturer, I manufacture everything and I really like to do value addition in my business. But going forward, I see that the services businesses are going to be much more interesting and profitable for the future. Again, I will just give you, like I said, my poet and Banya, I have another statement, which is there for what types of businesses. It's very difficult to pinpoint, but I have a very interesting take on what type of businesses you can do. So a boring and dull business is going to give you always more money than a sexy and glamorous business. All of us run after sexy and glamorous business, but a boring and dull business is where you have stability and a lot of money. So if you can take that as a very small testimony, because people who start new businesses look at doing something which is exciting. Unfortunately, that space is already too much full. And there are enough number of people who have lost tons of money, you know, making movies or flying airlines or, you know, doing all the fancy stuff. So look at businesses which have requirement, which are scalable and which are boring and dull.
Thank you, sir. So we have another question from audience, from Khushi Runwal, Oxford, UK. Sir, first question is, for a young student who aspires to be an entrepreneur, what would be...
I think she, you know, she can ask.
Yes, yes, she connected actually.
I don't mind. I can ask. Yeah, that's okay. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, clear.
Okay. Hello, sir. Jai Ho. First of all, it's a very, very inspiring talk. And I'm a complete commerce student at the moment. I had like my main question, which I think is relevant, is currently what's the importance of holding a business degree in the changing environment in order to run a business? Because I feel like it's changing a lot and I don't know how important it is that you need to have a degree in order to start a business. To what extent does it help you? And what else would you suggest? So yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Khushi. I think that's a very relevant question and very close to my heart. So I mentioned in my talk, you would have seen that Saraswati is a very important part of life and the future is all about Saraswati. But having said that, it is whatever you have learned is of no relevance other than the fact that you are learning to learn. If you learn to learn throughout your life, that is enough. The degree is not going to help you. I have done MBA from IIM Bangalore, which is the topmost university, and I have a right to say that. The degree is not what helps you. But while learning that degree, you learn how to learn. And if you can keep that learning throughout your life, whether you do commerce or engineering, I've seen 95% of the people who are successful are not doing the degree which they have done as a degree. But what is very important to do in that phase of life is to get inculcate into that habit of learning, which will stand you in very good stead in the future. And if you don't have that, the confidence level will be slightly low, but nothing more than that.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, I have another question. Sir, as we know that you were very fortunate to born in a well rich family with all well established business. Sir, but at every point of life, you proved your presence, you proved your place, you topped exams, then you multifolded your business. Then you created like your own success story. Sir, can you share your story from starting so that we can learn from your life journey? Some tips like...
See, there have been a lot of milestones. So I wanted to keep it more, which is useful rather than, you know, talking about my own journey, but I'll just give you a few highlights. One of my highlights of my, when I was the president of the chambers, I was interacting with all the government officers, the chief ministers, and I keep telling, I have a bragging right that I was presiding over an event in which the president of India was there. The president of India was there on the chair, and I was presiding as the president of the organization. So it is my bragging right to say that. But I think that is of less importance. But having said that, I'll have to talk about my entire business stories all over again, which might not be very interesting to everybody.
No. Just like tips, like inspiring points, just you said, which makes us success. Like,
For example, like I said, things are changing very fast.
Yes.
And early on in my life, I saw that one of my factories was not viable. So I had to take a hard decision either to linger on with that factory or to close that factory and move on. So, you know, those are the decisions which frame the entire this thing. And I've done that not once, four times. I've closed down four different factories because we are in an area and we are in an era which is changing so fast. So if you keep thinking of the past, it's not going to help you. So we need to, I have done that. I had a factory which was 35 years old with a union which was 35 years old with 400 employees. I had to take a quick decision. I closed down the factory in 1 month without any labor strike, talking to the people, explaining to them, giving them compensation and moving on. The same thing I did it when I had a factory in Goa. We used to make telecom cables. We used to make cables for fiber optic cables and jellyfish cables. Now, when the cell phones came, obviously they became obsolete. Everybody went wireless instead of a landline. So I had to close down the factory. I couldn't, you know, keep thinking, why is this affecting me? Why should I? You know, the mentality of becoming a victim is something which we need to avoid. I just decided one fine day that we are going to close this. Within 6 months, I just wiped off everything, closed it and came back. And then because I did that, I could start some other ventures wherein we could reach greater glory. Suppose I remove 400 employees, I could employ 1,000 people.
Okay.
So those are important milestones which have happened in businesses. And I have a separate, you know, presentation. The other thing is, in my businesses, I've always seen when you move from one business to another business, what is the sort of synergy which you have, which you bring to that business? You know, yesterday, Gautam was talking that when he moved from fashion to granite, he thought that even there was a fashion. And when he moved from granite to his new stone, engineered stone, it was basically the same customers who asked for it. So you need to have some sort of synergy when you move. So we always had synergy. Either we had the raw material in our control. So once I had copper as my base raw material, I kept on increasing the products in copper. I went on after automobiles. I went out of solar water heaters. I went out of after bus bars. I went after, you know, auto components and so many other products because I had mastery over the raw material. Or I had mastery over the customers. The customers were already loyal to me. So if we need take one of these things as an anchor point, then it's very easy to move on in businesses.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Sir, now our group captain, Ashokji Chordia, would like to ask a question. Sir, please.
Thank you, Suranaji. I am mighty thrilled to listen to you speak. You spoke with a lot of passion, there was a lot of depth, and I only wish I had been younger and made use of this talk. You very nicely touched upon Black Swan. I have read that book by Nassim Taleb, Nikola Taleb, but I didn't know the other part of it, the anti-fragile part of it. It's really fascinating to know that part also. I have got two small questions for you. In this era when people are in a hurry and don't have any time to read, what is the scope and what is the tip for the writers? People who are writing books or writing on any subjects, what is your tip to them? Because these days people don't have the time to read. Number one. Number two. Sorry, please go ahead.
No, go ahead. Complete your question.
The second question is, in your type of business, you can hire and fire people. Anyone who is not performing, you can just fire them. But in the armed forces where we have been dealing with people, we get the set of people we have. I mean, you cannot hire them, you cannot fire them. You have to make do with those people. How do you deal with such people? How do you keep motivated such people who you can't hire or you can't fire?
So I'll answer your second question first, before I come to the first question. You know, it's very easy to say in private sector, we can hire and fire. If you look at a manufacturing sector in the private sector, what are the type of people which you get? The top people, maybe not now, but say 15, 20 years back when it is relevant, all wanted to go either for a government job or wanted to go abroad. Those who were left wanted to go get into technology and IT services. I'll just take an offside here. I am from IIM Bangalore, a group of 140 people, out of which 100 engineers from IIT. Do you know how many people are in manufacturing today? Exactly 4. So people don't want to come into manufacturing. Don't be under the assumption that it's very easy for us to get good people and do it. On the other hand, the government gets the best people because everybody wanted a government job which is safe and secure. So the best people are actually in the government, not in the private sector. So what do you do with the people which you get and how do you motivate and get the best out of it? Now, this is one question which I keep talking to my leaders in my unit and tell them, do not assume that you will get the best qualities in the people. Look at the person, see what are the qualities, what you can train, and use him for what he is capable of. If you are able to do that, only if you are able to do that, you will be able to come out with a successful venture. There is no point in saying I don't get good quality people, because it's never going to happen. I just told you in the hierarchy of employment where we stand. And if we have to make a success, we have to ensure, we have to see what a person is capable of, train him to do better than that, and use him where he can be used. So that is a very simple this thing. On the other part, I also review the fact that people have stopped the habit of reading. In this days of easy YouTube channel, people come and talk and you know, probably Black Swan and Antifragile, I put it in 20 minutes. So it's very difficult for people to go through 6 days and 10 days to go through a book to understand it. But having said that, it is very important that people read. To all the youngsters here, I encourage you to read books, because that is the only way to be successful in life. Those who can't read books, there are huge interpretations of great books on YouTube. At least go through that. If you can't read the books itself, there is so much knowledge. There is a concept known as standing on the shoulders. All of us today are here because of not our achievements. Thousands of people have worked and we are standing on their shoulders and doing just 1 inch more. So they have done 1,000 feet, I have done 1 inch, but my height is 1,000 feet and 1 inch. So unless you know where the giants are standing, by reading the books, you will not be able to do that 1 inch over there. So that is a very important concept. Coming to the fact about writing a book, you know, even I have been toying with an idea of writing a book, but the dilemma which you face, where are the readers, is a very, very serious this thing. And unless you can make it very readable, very edible, very interesting, sort of, it's going to be very difficult. But I would still encourage you to write, because the very process of writing should itself be an encouragement to the person who's writing. That is all I can say. I know the situation is not that great. I hope I answered that.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Ashokji Chordia, for the question.
My mother is from the Choradia family, so I'm feeling happy that you asked. Yeah, please.
Now I would like to hand over mic to Riti Turkia from Nanded. She will have a rapid fire.
Yeah, Riti.
Jai Ho. First of all, am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Before I start rapid fire, there is tons of gratitude towards you, sir, because, you know, coming from such a heavy business platform and, you know, looking that, as you have told, ki pichle 50 saal mein jo cheez nahi hui, aage 10 saalon mein hogi, and, you know, being in that state to visualize those things is commendable in its own self, sir. Thank you so much for such an amazing talk. And yeah, moving forward towards rapid fire, again, we expect, sir, the answers can be rapid and full of fire. First question is, your favorite thing that you have experienced just because of success that you have achieved?
You know, the thing which I love the most is my morning walk in the open air and my golf. It's nothing to do with my success.
Okay. Nice. Yeah, such a great thing to, you know, hear from a businessman, a morning walk, like, see you. Nice. Next question we have, everyday motivation secret.
The thing which I have and which I keep telling my kids is add value. Add value to everything which you do. And once you add value, a small portion, if it comes back to you, you should be very happy.
Again, a really great message, sir. One-line message to youth.
Be passionate and go after it. Don't be apologetic. Be passionate. Keep trying. But on the second hand, I want to give one more line. Don't think that glory is a shortcut. You need to do a lot of donkey work before you can reach glory. So at youth, don't be afraid of donkey work. Keep doing repetitive work without complaining.
Okay. Again, a great one. Your favorite sport?
Golf right now, badminton before that.
Okay. Favorite book? Wow. Favorite quote?
And also Fountainhead.
Okay. Describe yourself in 3 words as a teenager.
As a teenager, happy, yeah. Go lucky. 3 words, happy, go lucky.
Wow. Amazing. Social media, according to you?
Dangerous double sword.
Oh my God, amazing. And lastly, your experience with Charamangal.
I have seen a few episodes. Interesting. Thanks, Marasa, for getting this platform ready and ensuring that the youth get to share a lot of things. Technology and Marasa enabled, I think this is a great platform.
Okay. Thank you so much for such an amazing rapid fire, sir. Moving forward, I would like to hand over the screen to Tanvangi. Thank you so much.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you so much, sir, for handling our questions in such a great manner. Now, I would like to ask Gautam sir, for his words, his experience of today, sir.
Are you able to hear?
Yeah. You're clear, Gautam.
Honestly, this is the first time that I have been hearing Devender formally, though we are in the same building. So today's experience was teaching me that what I missed all my life, education is so important. And unfortunately, I could not educate myself, and I had to be content with whatever.
Gautam, you have got muted.
Now?
Yeah, now you're clear.
So, I was happy to see the presentations done by Devender. And I was just going back to my college days that I wish I would also had the opportunity to study. So, I would have been more wiser. But I believe in learning each day of life. So that is why I was very keen to attend today. And I logged on to YouTube. So I was able to listen to him most of the time. So there are a lot of things that are common between what Devender thinks and what I was thinking. And a very important thing which I wanted to convey was the ability to take risk must be there in an entrepreneur. So this is one point which is important, because unless we take risk, we can never succeed. And this is what Devender has been doing, and he's been seeing the success. It's not necessary that you succeed in everything you do, but taking risk and the ability to take risk is very important. So this is what I have learned also again from Devender.
Thank you. Thank you, Gautam.
Thank you so much, sir. We are coming to end of this session. So I would like to thank the core committee, and I would like to thank Lakshita Di from Jalore. I would like to thank Pragbhai Ji for managing us so well. And I would like to thank Marasa for her constant blessing. And there's one more person I would like to thank today. That is Praful Talera uncle from Pune. He's the reason that most of us are connected. Thank you so much, sir. One more thing I would like to say to every one of you. If you like this session, please put your feedback in the group or on our social media, which is @YouthCharamangal on Instagram and as well as on Facebook. You can connect with us there, so that if there are more workshops or seminars or Virat Talks, you can get the notifications from there. Tomorrow, we have Sadhika Pragbha Virat with us on the Virat Talks. So stay tuned for tomorrow. For ending, I would like to pass the mic to Sadhika Pragbha Ji for Mangal Path.
Jai Ho. Thank you so much, Devendra Ji, and thank you so much, Gautam Ji. In two days, we have heard you. And the most important thing is that आपका और हमारा जो परिचय रहा इन पूरे युवा टीम के साथ वो मात्र एक फोन कॉल का था, और जो एंथुजियाज्म और जो अपनापन आपने इन यूथ के लिए दिखाया उसके लिए इस पूरे यूथ चरमंगल की ओर से आपको बहुत बहुत आभार। और जहां तक बात यूथ की है, आप दोनों का ही एंथुजियाज्म देखकर कहीं नहीं लगता कि आप सब इन youth से कहीं भी कम है, because I don't think youth is about age. It is always about the enthusiasm, the rapid fire you answered, and each and everything, the way you taught them in such an interesting manner. मुझे लगता है कि business की ऐसी बहुत सारी जो छोटी छोटी बारीकियां हैं, जो उनके बहुत सारे questions थे, because I can see they had prepared so many questions, but most of them were answered just in your talk, and they didn't even need to ask the questions. तो जहां जहां एक youth सोच सकता है, आपने उन उन कोनों को पकड़कर उसको पहले ही आंसर कर दिया कि क्वेश्चंस बचे ही नहीं। आप देख सकते हो कि सेशन जो इन्होंने टाइम रखा था क्वेश्चंस के लिए, दैट क्वेश्चंस एंडेड अप वेरी वेरी मच बिफोर द टाइम, और ये इस बात को साबित करता है कि आप बिल्कुल एक यूथ की तरह सोचते हैं। एंड यस, लाइक रिद्धि आस्क्ड यू एज अ टीनेजर, थ्री वर्ड्स That completes कि आप उन सारी जगहों को टच कर सकते हैं, and this is what makes a real businessman, as you quoted, एक पोयर और एक बढ़िया। Yes, very truly said, एक businessman वाकई एक poet का, एक कवि का imagination और एक बढ़िया की calculation लेकर अगर चले तो वो अपने business में किस तरह से सफल हो सकता है। बहुत बहुत आभार, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आपका। और ये सिर्फ एक आई सपोज ये एक प्रोग्राम का कनेक्शन नहीं रहेगा इस विराट यूथ चरम मंगल के साथ, ये एक ऐसा कनेक्शन है जो इन युवाओं को हमेशा याद रहेगा, और आप भी बिल्कुल इनके मेंटर्स की तरह इनको जीवन के हर क्षेत्र में गाइड करते रहें, ऐसा हमारा भाव है, और आप ऐसा करते रहेंगे ऐसा हमारा विश्वास भी है। अगेन आभार और मंगल पाठ। चतारी मंगलम, अरहंता मंगलम, सिद्धा मंगलम, साहू मंगलम, केवली पनतम, धम्मम मंगलम। चतारी लघुत्तमा, अरहंता लघुत्तमा, सिद्धा लघुत्तमा, साहू लघुत्तमा, केवली पनतो, धम्मो लघुत्तमो। चतारी शरणम पवज्जामि, अरहंते शरणम पवज्जामि, सिद्धे शरणम पवज्जामि, साहु शरणम पवज्जामि, केवली पनतम, धम्मम शरणम पवज्जामि। आप फूलो फलो हो जिंदगी मखमल मुलायम, आपकी हर खुशी पे है हमारी जान सदके। दुआ करते हैं चुपचाप दिल की थाप से हम, रहे जाते नवाजे हर घड़ी अरमान सबके। अमन और चैन से गुजरे आपका वक्त सारा, रुख बिखलती रहे यूं रूह की मुस्कान खुल के, रुख बिखलती रहे यूं रूह की मुस्कान खुल के। जय हो, जय हो, जय हो, सबका कल्याण हो, आमीन। और अब हम आभार प्रार्थना करें प्रणव के साथ।
पृथ्वी को धन्यवाद, पानी को धन्यवाद, अग्नि को धन्यवाद, वायु को धन्यवाद, हरितक को धन्यवाद, त्रस प्राणी धन्यवाद, धन्यवाद धन्यवाद, धन्यवाद धन्यवाद, धन्यवाद धन्यवाद, धन्यवाद धन्यवाद। सबका सहयोग मिला, आनंद का भोग मिला, दिल में उजास खिला, सुंदर सा आज मेला। दानी उत्साह के गुरुवर को धन्यवाद, धन्यवाद धन्यवाद, धन्यवाद धन्यवाद, धन्यवाद धन्यवाद, धन्यवाद धन्यवाद प्यारे माता पिता प्यारी संतान हो बढ़िया हम दम रहे सभ्यों में शान हो प्यारा पड़ोस हो परिजन को धन्यवाद 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 सब में सद्भाव हो प्रेमी स्वभाव हो दिल में भाई सखा के बड़ बड़ के प्यार हो सबके कल्याण के भावों को धन्यवाद 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 जय हो
जय हो. थैंक यू प्रणव एंड थैंक यू टू आवर स्पीकर्स एंड अबव वेरी मच थैंक यू टू ऑल आवर ऑडियंस फॉर लिसनिंग टू अस टुडे. थैंक यू एवरीवन एंड वी मीट अगेन टुमारो द सेम टाइम फॉर विराट टॉक्स एपिसोड 3 डे 3. थैंक यू सो मच.
Let me leave.
Let's go.